In this video, we are going to develop a cybersecurity product called CryptoWAF. It is an advanced web application firewall which automagically protects any user data with military-grade encryption, as well as stopping serious hacking attacks such as XSS and SQL injections. Okay, I admit I didn't invent this product, and this is just a capture the flag challenge I created for our ALLES CTF 2021, but this is more than just a CTF challenge, because like the recent screenshotter challenge I made, this is based on a real-life product that I encountered during a security audit. But this is not going to be a regular CTF video walkthrough. In this video, I want to focus a bit more on the idea of the challenge and how I built it. I think it's a unique perspective for a bug hunter or aspiring security researcher. Understanding or imagining how a product was developed can help you when hunting for bugs. There will be spoilers ahead, so if you want to try to solve this challenge yourself, you can find the link to the challenge below. If you are here for a regular CTF walkthrough, check out the video by Bug Bounty Reports Explained. He is another YouTuber who solved this challenge during the CTF and even got first blood. In his video, he will walk you through how he approached and solved the challenge. Anyway, so what is the idea for this challenge? As I mentioned, this challenge is based on a product that exists in real life, but I implemented the code for the challenge myself. The vulnerability and attack idea is inspired by what was found in the real product, but I want to emphasize that I made here a very basic, minimal, and insecure implementation of the general idea. So it obviously doesn't compare at all to the real mature product. Anyway, let's look at the challenge. I like challenges where the source code is available. This means there's no trickery, no guessing, all the information you need is in front of you. And so if you cannot solve it, you know you lack some knowledge or skills. I know that might sound harsh, but that's what I love when playing CTFs myself. I have the full code, so if I cannot solve it, I still have to learn more. And that's motivating to me. Anyway, nowadays, basically 99% of all web applications come with Docker files or even Docker Compose files that are being used for local development, testing, and even deployment. And they are awesome because they make the test setups for research very easy and also give you a quick overview of all the components. And yes, most bug bounty programs are about attacking proprietary black box closed source software, but there are many bug bounties for open source apps as well, for example GitLab. So this challenge is a great learning opportunity. Okay, but what is the idea here? What is this CryptoWAF? Let me tell you about the problem this product will solve. Let's say you have developed a note-taking application and you want to take privacy seriously. Now imagine you have a bug like an SQL injection and your database is stolen. Do you want to be responsible for leaking those extremely private notes of your users? No, you want to protect them. Ideally, you don't even want to have access to the notes of your users yourself. So you decide you want to encrypt them. But if you encrypt it yourself in the database, then you know the private key and you can still decrypt everything and read the private notes, and you don't like that. So here comes CryptoWAF. This CryptoWAF product is a layer sitting between your app and the user, and it automagically encrypts user data passing through it, which means you as the developer don't have to do anything. You can focus on making a great notes app, and the CryptoWAF developers just have to focus on securely handling the crypto. Perfect separation of responsibility. Now, I want to be clear, this is not the best solution for this problem, and what I will show you is not perfect. There are way better and more correct ways of doing this, but still, I think it's an interesting idea for a product. So let's think about the implementation details. Remember, we want to have a layer sitting between the user and the application, so the HTTP requests and responses pass through our CryptoWAF. Encrypting the user data seems simple. When a request is coming through our system, the HTTP request might carry data. This could be a POST request with URL form encoded data or JSON. And so it's easy for the CryptoWAF to take the values in the request, encrypt it, and forward it to the actual app. Now the app only receives the encrypted values and never knows what really was written. And this is how it looks in practice. If you add a note here, you see text, But if you would look at the site without the WAF crypto layer, all the data is encrypted. You need to go through the crypto layer to get the real data back. But do you really want to encrypt every value coming through? You will quickly realize you run into practical problems, specifically with identifiers. Let's say you write a comment on a post, you submit the request, and it has the comment text as well as the ID of the post this comment belongs to. If both values are encrypted, the app receives an encrypted ID rather than the number. Now you don't know which post the comment belongs to. You need the real ID value. So IDs must not be encrypted in the setup, which means you have to define exceptions for certain values to be not encrypted. When you look into the app.py source code of the crypto part, you can find here the encryptParams function, which defines exactly these exceptions. The submitted data keys UUID, IID, PK primary key, username and password are not encrypted. And of course, in a proper product, this should be configurable by the customer. Okay, one practical problem solved. But what about decryption? Imagine a user wants to read the note that they have written. If the app is implemented with a clean API returning JSON data, then you could just do it in reverse. If encrypted values arrive from the app, you decrypt them and return it to the browser. But many websites have server-side template rendering, so the note could be embedded within the HTML response. And now you don't know which parts are encrypted and which parts are not. This can be solved by making a clear pattern for encrypted strings. This way, you can find and decrypt them easily. So let's have a look into the decrypt data function in the source code. Here you can see that it uses a regular expression looking for a string starting with encrypt, colon, and then expects a BASIC64 encoded text. It then goes through all the matched strings, decrypts them, and replaces them in the data. So let's think about a fundamental design issue of this implementation. Remember the main purpose of this crypto layer? We, as the developer of the Notes app, do not want to handle the private data of users, so we use the service to encrypt and decrypt the data for us. Our hands stay clean. But the other promise of the CryptoWAF is that when your database leaks or is exploited through an SQL injection, the data will be worthless for the attacker because all the nodes are encrypted with the key we don't have on our server. It's the same reason why we hash password. It protects us from a compromised database. But is that really true? Here is the potential design flaw. Let's say we compromise the database and we get an encryption value. How can we decrypt it? Well, we happen to have a service that happily decrypts any value when it's returned by the app. So if we manage to inject this string into a response, the CryptoWAF would happily decrypt it for us, right? The problem is just how to actually do that, because when we would insert this as a node, this string would be encrypted, then stored in the database, and when returned, it would be decrypted to its original encrypted format. So it wouldn't work. And so we need to implement a first flaw in the code to make that possible. That's one of the issues you need to figure out when attacking this. Looking around the app, you might notice that when you delete a node, the response will be a redirect where the redirect URL is also shown in the response body. And the value here is a UUID. And UUIDs are excluded and not encrypted. So this is the way you can control what is reflected here onto the page. So if we take an encrypted string, place it here, we can see that the result will be the decrypted value now. So this is how you can decrypt any leaked value. And basically, this defeats the crypto part of the CryptoWAF. But how do we get the encrypted data in the first place? When you look at where the flag is located for the challenge, you can see that it's added as a node for the flagger user. So somehow we have to leak the database. And here is where the other bug is. The main app had an SQL injection vulnerability in the order by clause. And I chose this because I didn't want it to be easily discoverable and solvable with SQLmap. And it seems like SQLmap fails to identify the vulnerability. Here I run SQLmap against the URL and you can see no injectable parameter was found. This was, by the way, without the CryptoWAF. But when reading the source code, the vulnerability is super clear. Here is a typical string concatenation failure. So I guess this is a great example how a genuinely awesome tool like SQLmap still has limitations and how a source code audit would very easily reveal this vulnerability. But it wouldn't be a CryptoWAF, a web application firewall, if it also wouldn't prevent hacking attempts, such as an SQL injection in the first place. And the source code of the WAF has here this function, WAF param, which checks the get and post parameters for attacks. If there is any occurrence of select, union, alert, script, sleep, or even just single and double quotes, the WAF will block the request and return an error. So all we need is to bypass the WAF, and then we can use the blind SQL injection to leak the encrypted node of flagger and combine it with the design flaw of the crypto part to decrypt the flag. But I don't tell you how to bypass the flag. The flaw is on the screen right now, so maybe you can see it. But I would say for the full solution, you should check out the video from Greg of Bug Bounty Reports Explained, or look at my solution script in the description. You can find all the challenge files and source code on GitHub. Also, I want to say I was very impressed by Greg as he got first blood to solve the challenge before any of the other teams. What the heck, CTF players? I always believe you to be the best, and now we have some random bug bounty hunter coming into our space and then killing it? What? Of course, I'm just kidding, but I have a theory. I'm a strong believer that good CTF players who solve a challenge like this will also be great bug bounty hunters. And I think here we saw evidence of that. Well, the reverse of it. Greg is spending a lot of time studying the top bug reports for his videos. These are not the basic XSS subdomain takeovers or whatever issues. These are really impressive findings, and they are often complex, sometimes difficult to understand. So they are very similar to CTF challenges. So I believe exposing himself to these more advanced topics instead of doing the same basic boring bug bounty stuff all the time made him a successful CTF player as well.